like an angel. Walk like an angel. Talk like an angel. But I got wise. You're the devil in disguise. Or as you are.
The Devil in Disguise, then, is the context that is going to get you thinking about our poem Lamia. It was written by John Keats in 1819, the year that he produced many of his famous odes, and some people refer to it as the living year simply because it's when he produced his most famous poetry. Keats' brother Tom had died of tuberculosis, and this year was the year that Keats took the decision to finish his job at Guy's Hospital. He was training to be an anaesthetist and to devote himself to poetry. He was living with Charles Brown at the time. You should have seen the introductory tutorial with a little bit of contextual information about Keats and his life at the time. He was living with Charles Brown, and Fanny Brawne was living in the house next door. They lived in kind of an annex. It was actually Charles Brown's house. And so Keats had met Fanny Brawne, the love of his life. He was desperately in love with her, but it was unrequited love. There was no way that her mother was going to let her marry a penniless poet. And she was quite a flirt herself. She wouldn't commit to him either. And he felt he kind of tortured emotionally by this. And so we can understand why the female characters in a lot of his poems of this time are this femme fatale character who kind of taunt men with their sexuality, make them fall in love with them, and then ruthlessly leave them with absolutely nothing. We have a mythical start to Lamia then. It starts off upon a time before the fairy broods drove nymph and satyr from the prosperous woods. So straight away we've got a conventional fairy tale beginning, and it is quite clearly established that we are in the fantasy realm as opposed to reality. Now that is a key theme in this poem, the conflict between the imagination and reality, or our dreams and reality. And we start off in a dream-like world in the woods. So that is our first setting. And as I say, our narrative voice introduces it as a fairy tale. The first character we meet then is this nymph. And a nymph is a female spirit. And she seems to be, the narrative is pervaded with symbols of female sexuality. So we've got pearls, we've got her white feet, and we're told that the tritons, the satyrs, withered and adored at the feet of this nymph. And in particular, we've got the character Hermes. We're told a celestial heat burnt from his winged heels to either ear. He is incredibly lustful for this nymph. Hermes then, he sets himself a mission. He wants to find her. The sweet nymph might nowhere be found, and so he rested on the lonely ground, pensive and full of painful jealousies. There as he stood, he heard a mournful voice. And that's when he comes across this snake. And that snake is the first description of our key character, Lamia. We're told that he heard a mournful voice, such as once heard in gentle heart destroys all pain but pity. So our first introduction to Lamia, she's characterised as mournful, having a voice that would evoke pity. So as a reader, we feel sympathy for her at this point. And she expresses that she feels trapped. When from this wreathed tomb shall I awake and move in a sweet body fit for life and love and pleasure, our miserable me. We've got our mournful M alliteration there. And she hasn't experienced love and pleasure, and she feels they're essential parts of life. Now that relates to Keats' ideas about the human soul. He says we're not souls until we acquire identities. So we're not truly alive until we have had experiences. And that's what Lamia longs for. And Hermes then makes her a promise. He says, possess whatever bliss thou canst devise, telling me where my nymph is fled. So in other words, you can have whatever bliss you want if you tell me what I want to hear. And so they strike a deal. Lamia tells Hermes, thou shalt behold her, Hermes, thou alone, if thou wilt, as thou swearest, grant my boon. And a boon is like a prize or something that you want. So she says to Hermes, if you help me, I'll help you. And then we hear her wish. I was a woman. Let me have once more a woman's shape and charming as before. So Lamia wishes for a transformation. You can see the kind of second half of the shaking hands there. This deal has been struck. And as a result of that, Hermes gets what he wants. He is united with the nymph. We see a slightly deceptive side to Lamia there, because she's hidden the nymph, and yet, in order to get what she wants, she will unveil her to Hermes. Now, although the picture shows this happy union, it's not happy at first. We're told that when she is discovered, the nymph cowered. She faded before Hermes, self-folding like a flower. So we've got the fact that the nymph is scared of Hermes, and yet he takes her hand. Listen to this bit. The god, fostering her chilled hand, she felt the warmth. Her eyelids opened bland, and like new flowers at morning song of bees, bloomed and gave up her honey to the lees. Now, honey is always a symbol of sexuality. It's something that a motif maybe that we can trace through this poem and through Keats and romantic poems in general. Remember that these poems were subject to censorship. So there could not be an out and out sex scene in this poem. So we have to have suggestion, we have to have imagery, and honey is usually a symbol of sexuality. So we have this sexual awakening of the nymph, and at first it seems against her will. Yet Hermes wins the power struggle. The man wins the power struggle here. And what we're told is that into the green recessed woods they flew, nor grew they pale as mortal lovers do. So the fantasy, the mythical lovers there don't grow pale. Their love doesn't fade. And it is implied then that they have everlasting happiness. Of course, Hermes struck this deal, and so the deal is that Lamia will be transformed. And we have an incredibly vivid description of Lamia's transformation. Left to herself, the serpent now began to change. The colours all inflamed throughout her train. She writhed about, convulsed with scarlet pain. And those verbs there, writhed and convulsed, really characterise this section. We've got words like hot, glazed, inflamed, convulsed, scarlet pain. We're told that she melts the grass as the lava ravishes the med. Med is short for meadow. So it's a passionate and violent change. Incredibly vivid colour imagery in here. And what happens is that she is, first of all, completely destroyed. Nothing but pain and ugliness were left. So at first she is reduced, but then she is beautifully transformed into a woman. Into the air, her new voice luting soft, cried Lysias, gentle Lysias. So she is transformed into a woman. And when she's transformed, she has her thoughts on one thing. She wants to find this man, and his name is Lysias. We're told that she's now a lady bright, a full-born beauty, new and exquisite. So it's the first time then that she's characterised as a woman. Her appearance has totally changed. So the ugliness and the pain of the previous verse is contrasted. We've got our B alliteration there to emphasise the beauty. A lady bright, full-born beauty. So our B alliteration there really highlights the power, I guess, of her beauty. Now, Lamia is described as a character displaying a series of contrasts. She was a maid more beautiful than ever twisted braid, a virgin purest lipped, yet in the lore of love, deep lends to the heart's red core. Okay, so she's a virgin, she's inexperienced, and yet she knows all about love. It actually implies that she's sexually experienced there. So she's a really contradictory character, and those qualities would obviously be impossible in a human being, but in a mythical character, anything's possible. We're told that she's not 1 hour old, yet of sciential brain. So in other words, she is inexperienced again in terms of education. She is not learned, and yet she's incredibly clever, sciential brain. And she has the ability to unperplex bliss from its neighbour, pain. Keats spoke a lot of pleasure and pain, and his belief was that you couldn't experience one without the other, that a life lived purely in pursuit of pleasure was unrealistic, but similarly, a life lived where you only experience pain is not a life well lived. It would not complete your soul. Now, we're told that she is resting at the foot of these wild hills, and we find out why. She has gone to find somebody in particular, and now we have a flashback. So the flashback, you can see that she's a snake, but this snake is in love, and this snake is in love with a character called Lysias. How is Lysias first described? Like a young Jove with calm, uneager face. Love is romanticized here. We're told she used to travel in her dreams, and in one such reverie, she saw the young Corinthian Lysias and fell into swooning love of him. So swooning, suggesting that this love is kind of all-powerful, all-encompassing, and it makes her swoon, so she has a physical reaction to him. And so her mission, when she's a woman, is to make Lysias fall in love with her. So she waits for him when he is returning from a fishing trip, and she beheld him coming near, more near. So she watches and she waits. Lamia here, then, she's presented as quite a calculating character. She's actually characterized as quite sly and quite cunning, so neighbored to him, yet so unseen she stood. He passed shut up in mysteries, his mind wrapped like his mantle. His mantle is his cloak, while her eyes followed his steps. So she's worked all of this out. And she calls to him. She says, Lysias, look back. Will you leave me on the hills alone? And he turns and he sees her. And it's the concept of love at first sight. Soon his eyes had drunk her beauty up, thus began to adore. So as soon as he sees her, he falls desperately in love with her. We can see our femme fatale characteristics here. Somebody who is so beautiful, or a woman who is so beautiful, that she will make men fall in love with her purely by the strength of their beauty. And he actually refers to her as a goddess. At first, he sees her as something that is unearthly, something that is mythical. He calls her a goddess, and he seems to pledge devotion to her straight away. Ah, goddess, see whether my eyes can ever turn from thee. In other words, he's smitten and he never wants to be parted from her again. Again, Lamia is characterized as a calculating character here. She makes him fall in love with her, and then, true to the femme fatale archetype, she says that she's going to leave him straight away. Thou canst not ask me here to roam over these hills and vales where no joy is. Finer spirit cannot breathe below in human climes and live. It cannot be. Adieu. So she dismisses him. And the reason she dismisses him is because she says that the mortal world, the city, or everyday life is not somewhere that she can dwell. So she characterizes herself there as this mythical character, this character that is almost too good for reality, this figment of the imagination, some might say. And this makes Lysias swoon. He, sick to lose the amorous promise of her lone complaint, swooned. Amorous is a promise of love. And as soon as he is threatened with the idea of losing her, he faints. Lamia then takes that opportunity, and while he has swooned, she enchants him. And then she wakes him with a kiss. She put her new lips to his and gave afresh the life she had so tangled in her mesh. That imagery, it reminds me of a spider, of tangling somebody in your web. This idea that she has captured him. She's got him where she wants him, the femme fatale archetype. And she will use him as she wishes. And she enchants him and she pulls the wool over his eyes, bidding him raise his droopy head and clear his soul of doubt, for that she was a woman. So she enchants him into believing that she's not this mythical creature. She's not a figment of his imagination, but she is a mortal woman. So she dupes him. Lysias from death woke into a maze. Then from a maze into delight he fell. So she wakes him up and he falls even more in love with her. Why does she do it? Well, you can see in the yellow box, gentle Lamia judged and judged aright that Lysias could not love in half a fright. In other words, if he's frightened of her, he can't possibly love her. So what does she do? So threw the goddess off and won his part more pleasantly by playing a woman's part. So she takes on the role of a woman. She deceives him. And in doing so, she feels more secure that he will love her completely. The scene changes then. This mythical snake who has been transformed into a woman, or seemingly transformed into a woman, because we get the impression that this is all an illusion. They move to the town of Corinth, and they come across this character here, and his name is Apollonius. And the reaction that Apollonius causes is one that creates tension in the poem and one that causes alarm. In the blue box, you've got the reaction to Apollonius. Her fingers he pressed hard as one came near with curled grey beard, sharp eyes and smooth bald crown, slow-stepped and robed in philosophic gown. Now, philosophy then is often aligned with logic, and that's what Apollonius represents. He represents logic, reality, philosophy. He is the opposite then of Lamia, who is a product of the imagination and of dreams. And you can see she shudders. She asks Lysias, why do you shudder, love, so ruefully? And Lysias' response foreshadows the problems that Apollonius is going to cause this couple. 'Tis Apollonius sage, my trusty guide and good instructor, but tonight he seems the ghost of folly haunting my sweet dreams. It's interesting because if Apollonius represents reason and therefore represents the truth, we can see that Lysias is blind to him. Tonight he chooses to ignore Apollonius. He hides from him, and therefore he hides from reason. Lysias has given himself up completely to Lamia. Apollonius is described by Lysias as the ghost of folly. Now, folly is foolishness. So this idea that there is a hint of foolishness in Lysias's dreams, but he chooses to ignore it. The description of the ghost adds a kind of deathly imagery, a sinister element to this part of the poem. And yet Keats cuts the narrative off there. While yet he spake, they had arrived before a pillared porch with lofty portal door. The reader's left unsatisfied. We don't know what the problem is with Apollonius, but Keats, our omniscient narrator, deliberately cuts it off and tells us that they move and they go into this house and they shut themselves off from the world. It's a place that can't be discovered by anybody else in the town. We're told it was a place unknown sometime to any but those two alone. So they are cut off from reality. Lysias gives himself completely up to his dreams. But part one ends on a sour note. The flitter-winged verse must tell for truth's sake what woe afterwards befell. And woe is pain and sorrow. So we have foreshadowing there that this story is not going to end well. And Keats says that it would be a comic, happy ending if we ended here. There's an explicit hint that tragedy or woe is around the corner. 'Twould humour many a heart to leave them thus, shut from the busy world of more incredulous. So it would make you happy if we could leave them here. But we know that woe is around the corner. Part two then opens with comments on love. Love in a hut with water and crust, is love forgive us cinders, ashes and dust? The assonance there of that "uh" sound, or the repeated vowel sound, sounds very mundane, it sounds very everyday, and that's the point. That's what Keats is saying, that the reality of love is that it is mundane and it becomes unromantic over time. However, the omniscient narrator introduces this sense of foreboding. Had Lysias lived? Tells us that he doesn't live. We're also told, too short was their bliss to breed distrust and hate. In other words, love that doesn't last is blissful. It doesn't allow time for the relationship to sour. And the explicit comment, all this came a ruin, tells us that this beautiful and blissful time that they're having now, when they're holed up in this fairy palace, is going to go wrong. The home is described with this incredibly sensuous imagery. It's described as a purple-lined palace of sweet sin. We've got our P alliteration there. We've got our S sibilant, incredibly sensuous tone. Again, due to the censorship laws, Keats can't tell us about their activities in this house. However, it is implied through the sensuous imagery, the rich imagery, that they have given themselves over completely to physical pleasure at this point. The setting is, it's idealized, it's enchanting, or enchanted even, but it doesn't sound real. We've got the heavens appearing through through a gap in the ceiling. We've got an airy texture. We've got curtains that float into the room. So it really does sound enchanted and idealized. But all of a sudden, Lysias hears a sound. When from the slope side of a suburb hill, deafening the swallow's twitter, came a thrill of trumpets. Lysias started, the sounds fled, but left a thought buzzing in his head. The world outside is calling Lysias back. And he is reminded for the first time that life is going on outside this room and that there is a world outside that room that exists that he had forgotten about because he had given himself over completely to Lamia, or to think about our allegorical interpretation, he'd given himself completely over to his imagination, given himself completely over to his dreams. Reality has not got a look in. He's rejected it. Lamia sees this and she thinks that Lysias pines for the mortal world. She saw this with pain and she realizes what Keats is perhaps trying to show us. Look at this key quotation. But a moment's thought is passion's passing bell. And the seriousness of that quotation is highlighted through the P alliteration. And this idea that if we think about love too much, we can overthink something. And if we overthink something, then it is destroyed. A passing bell is a symbol of a death. A bell was always rung when there was a hanging, for example, in Victorian England. So it really tells us that thought kills love. Logic kills love. Love isn't logical. And we shouldn't try to understand it. Lysias asks Lamia, why do you sigh, fair creature? And she explains, why do you think you've deserted me? You've dismissed me. So she wants to consume him completely. And our dreams and the imagination can do that, can't they? They can consume us. And desperate to prove his love for her, he pleads with her. And his language really becomes very possessive. He says that he kind of wants to possess her, to own her, and to become one with her. Look at the language. I'm striving how to fill my heart with deeper crimson, to entangle your soul in mine, to labyrinth you there. Okay, and a labyrinth is a maze, so something that we can get trapped in. So love is described as all-consuming. The language is really quite negative, even though it sounds very passionate. To prove his love, then, he proposes. And he proposes from quite selfish and quite human reasons. He wants to show her off. He thinks that her love makes him superior. And so he says, let my foes choke and my friends shout afar, while through the thronged streets your bridal car wheels round its dazzling spokes. You could argue, I think, that he objectifies her here. He wants to show her off as a trophy. And her reaction is one of fear. She reluctantly agrees. Now, why is that? Well, she doesn't want to be unveiled. While they're in this house and they are separate from the rest of the world, they are protected. But she knows, as we've said before, she knows that thought kills the imagination. She knows that reality kills dreams. When we wake up, our dreams end. And so she knows that if she has to mingle with the human world, then the fragility of her situation, well, it might well collapse under the pressure. And the pressure that Lysias puts on Lamia is really quite cruel. It says his passion, cruel grown, took on a hue fierce, as 'twas possible in one whose brow had no dark veins to swell. So he's not an angry character, but he is cruel grown. He becomes fierce. And it is when he becomes this powerful character that she responds to him. She gives in. We're told she loved the tyranny, okay? Tyranny is from the word tyrant, somebody who exerts power over another. Lamia seems to want to be dominated. She's submissive to Lysias, the way that maybe Keats wanted Fanny Brawne to be submissive to him. He wasn't a strong, domineering character. He was only about 5'1", Keats. So he wasn't a domineering character, and he didn't have the strength of character to say to hell with it to all of his critics and to make Fanny Brawne submit to him. So maybe it's a bit of wish fulfillment there, because Lysias, in doing so, in becoming dominant, has invokes this change in Lamia. She consented to the hour when to the bridal he should lead his paramour. So she agrees, but she has one condition. When Lysias asks her to invite her friends and family, and she responds that she has none. She says that her parents are dead and she has no friends. Her condition is this: do not bid old Apollonius. From him, keep me hid. The white box there, the bottom of this picture, really sums up why that is. She knows that Apollonius represents reason, because she represents the imagination. She's a fantasy creature. Then she knows that she will crumble if Apollonius goes nearer. Reason destroys the imagination. Lamia then, she's not happy about this wedding. We've got a sense of foreboding throughout the whole preparations. And again, we've got the theme that appearances are deceptive. This fair unknown had not a friend, so being left alone, she set herself how to dress the misery in fit magnificence. So to dress the misery, to hide her misery in magnificence. So she will look happy, she will look like the blushing and beautiful bride, but inside she is incredibly miserable. This reminds us perhaps of the deceptive nature of Lamia's character. And in getting ready for the wedding then, she starts to transform the palace, till in short space the glowing banquet room shone with wide arched grace. We're told that the entire room is enchanted. She puts a spell on it and she transforms it to a very natural setting. But there are hints that it's not, well, Keats keeps reminding us it's not real. The imagery used to describe this section is incredibly vivid. We've got auditory imagery, so we've got sounds that are the music. We've got the scents of oils and of incense. And we've got our visual imagery as well. And the visual imagery is very natural, again, because Keats and the Romantics idealized the natural world. A haunting music, sole perhaps and lone supporter of the fairy roof, made moan throughout, as fearful the whole charm might fade. Okay, so the only thing supporting this roof is music. And then we've got our natural ingredients to really develop the beauty of this scene. Fresh carved cedar, mimicking a glade of palm and plantain, met from either side. And beneath all, there ran a stream of lamps straight on from wall to wall. And once she's enchanted the house, then she retires. Lamia, regal dressed, silently paced about. And as she went, in pale, contented sort of discontent. And look at the oxymoron there. Contentment, happiness, discontent, unhappiness. And she is in contented sort of discontent. She's happy, although she's unhappy. She looks around at what she's done, approving all. She faded at self-will and shut the chamber up, close, hushed and still, complete and ready for revels rude, when dreadful guests would come to spoil her solitude. She knows then the guests will ruin her peaceful existence with Lysias. We've got our sense of foreboding and reality. The real world is described as dreadful, rude, and something that spoils the imagination. Time shifts to the next day then. Time skips forward with the phrase, the day appeared. The guests are described as gossip. Okay, so again, our negative description of people in the real world continued. The narrator at the start of this stanza directly addresses Lysias and directly asks him why he tempted fate, I beg your pardon. Oh, senseless Lysias, madman. Okay, he calls him a madman and he says, why do you flout silent blessing fate? Flout is to tempt. So why did you tempt fate and show to common eyes these secret bowers? So why are you trying to join the imagination and dreams to the real world? In other words, Keats understands that that cannot happen. Amongst these guests, these busy guests who enter, hurried, mazed, curious and keen, Apollonius arrived and looked thereon with eyes severe. Okay, so if Apollonius is reason and reality, we're told that reason and reality is severe. And he has seen or foreseen a problem. He looked thereon with eyes severe, as though some knotty problem had now begun to thaw. 'Twas just as he foresaw. So Apollonius brings worldly wisdom, and he knows that a world and a life based on the imagination and dreams cannot last. Apollonius then explains to Lysias why he's there, and look at the language, the imagery of infection is rife in this section. This idea that reality somehow infects our dreams, it turns them sour. Apollonius tells Lysias, 'tis no common rule for uninvited guests to force himself upon you and infest with an unbidden presence the bright throng of younger friends. Yet I must do this wrong. I must. He seems to think he's got no choice but to somehow help Lysias or to somehow reveal the illusion surrounding Lamia. But the language, uninvited, force, infest, unbidden, tells us that sometimes reality can be unwelcome. And of course that was relevant for Keats, because in reality it brought him illness, it brought him pain, it brought him sorrow. Again, Keats cuts off that narrative. We don't hear the end of that conversation because we switch to these images of opulence and sensuous luxury when we're describing the banquet room. It reminds me of Gatsby's party, and it might help you to understand it if you understand that link. Fitzgerald was massively influenced by Keats. He was his favourite poet, and I think that you can see a lot of borrowings in Fitzgerald's work from Keats's rich imagery. Of wealthy lustre was the banquet room. 12 sphered tables by silk seats in sphered. The heavy gold of cups and goblets in huge vessels, wine came from the gloomy tun with merry shrine, thus loaded with a feast the tables stood. So you've got the language of plenty, loaded with a feast, heavy gold. The sounds in those words forces you to slow down. I find it really hard to say 12 sphered tables by silk seats in sphered. We're meant to slow down, we're meant to take our time and appreciate the richness that the imagination furnishes the real world with, I think. And yet, the guests aren't interested in this true love story. They just care about the cost of the wedding. We're told the guests moved to the feast and themselves in order placed around the silken couches, wondering whence all this mighty cost and blaze of wealth could spring. And then we're told that they get drunk. We're told when the happy vintage touched their brains, louder they talk, and louder come the strains of powerful instruments. Again, it's like the climactic section of Gatsby's party when the orchestra strikes up and people start singing and people get drunker and drunker, and it builds to this dramatic climax. We were told, louder they talk and louder come the strains of powerful instruments, the gorgeous dyes, the space, the splendour of the draperies, the roof of awful richness, nectarous cheer, beautiful slaves, and Lamia's self appear. So Lamia appears now, when the wine has done its rosy deed. Why is that? Well, perhaps because we know that wine dulls the senses, and she doesn't want people to be too alert. She is afraid of reality. She's afraid of being unveiled. And yet, of course, we know that Apollonius is always going to be Lamia's downfall. Reality is always going to bring an end to our dreams. And he fixes his eye on her. And here's Keats' comment on that. Do not all charms fly at the mere touch of cold philosophy? Okay, so philosophy, reason, the real world is described as cold. And Apollonius has come to represent logic and reason. We're told philosophy will clip an angel's wings, conquer all mysteries, unweave a rainbow. And erewhile, it made the tender person's Lamia melt. Because what happens is Apollonius stares at her and it turns her cold. The bald-head philosopher had fixed his eye without a twinkle or stare full on the alarmed beauty of the bride, troubling her sweet pride. And when Lysias sees this, he takes her hand and it's cold. Lamia, what means this? Knowest that man? Poor Lamia answered not. So can you see how the narrator sympathises with her here? Poor Lamia. So he seems to align himself with Lamia. He feels sorry for her. He seems to be on the side of the imagination. Lamia, he cried in no soft-toned reply. So she is completely stunned into silence. Through staring at her, through seeing her for what she really is, Apollonius has caused some kind of change in her. Our dramatic climax is complete then when the music stops. The loud revelry grew hush, the stately music no more breathes. The myrtle sickened in a thousand wreaths. By degrees, voice, lute, and pleasure ceased. So we're told that Apollonius has brought an end not only to the music, but he has made the trees wither and die. Okay, so this natural imagery has decayed. And pleasure ceased. He has stopped pleasure. So maybe it's a comment on how reality does not allow us pleasure, does not allow us to enjoy the imagination. And Lysias is furious. He refers to Apollonius as a grey-beard wretch. He says, "Mark how possessed his eyelids stretch around his demon eyes. My sweet bride withers at their potency." It's ironic there. He refers to Apollonius as a demon. And yet the reader knows that Lamia actually is the demon. She's the snake. But Lysias has been so caught up in his imagination and dream that he refuses to believe anything of logic and reality. Apollonius then refers to Lysias as a fool. "Shall I see thee made a serpent's prey?" And when Lysias hears that, he echoes, "A serpent," echoed he. "No sooner said than with frightful screams she vanished." So as soon as Lysias sees her for what she is, as soon as he names her as a serpent, she dies. Look at the description. "In the bride's face no soft bloom misted the cheek, no passion did illume. Lamia, no longer fair, sat there a deathly white." So she's completely destroyed. And she vanishes and dies as soon as he realizes that she is just a figment of the imagination. She's not real. And we're told, and it's cut off at the end there, but we're told Lysias' arms were empty of delight. As were his limbs of life from that same night. On the high couch he lay. His friends came round, supported him. No pulse or breath they found. And in its marriage robe, the heavy body wound. So when Lysias is deprived of Lamia, when Lysias is deprived of the imagination, and using again our allegorical comparisons, when Keats is deprived of his love, when Keats is deprived of poetry, what's the result? Well, that figure, Lysias, Keats, the poet, the dreamer, will die. The poem seems to conclude then that a life that is purely lived of the imagination will end in death. That a life that does not allow you to dream, does not allow you to have access to the imagination, and is one that is purely governed by thought and by reality, leads to no joy and no happiness. So perhaps Keats wants us to conclude that, as I said, to complete the soul and to live a life well lived, you've got to have balance. And that, I think, is the key message of Lamia.